In January 1986, the world lost one of its preeminent musicians when, at the age of 54, Indian classical sitarist Pandit Nikhil Banerjee died of a sudden heart attack. Though Nikhil Banerjee had often traveled, taught, and performed in the West, he was largely unknown and unappreciated outside the rarefied environment of North Indian Hindustani classical music. A shy and humble person, he never sought the limelight. In fact, he shunned it in his quiet and dignified pursuit of spiritual transcendence through music.
Best, you see. I had a big hope for his future. And we all missing.
We all missing.
A warm welcome to all music lovers and music stalwarts who have gathered here to celebrate our beloved Pandit Nikhil Banerjee's 89th birth anniversary. We have among us music stalwarts such as Pandit Devi Prasad Chatterjee ji, Pandit Parth Pratim Chatterjee ji, Pandit Abhijit Banerjee, who will be sharing their experiences and thoughts about Pandit Nikhilji after I have introduced them briefly, because they themselves are great musicians. One of the senior most, our first speaker would be Pandit Devi Prasad Chatterjee, renowned artist. You cannot hear?
Can you increase the volume of your...
Yeah, the volume is very low.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, little better.
It is better?
Little better. More would be appreciated.
All right. The first speaker for today is Pandit Devi Prasad Chatterjee. Everyone knows of him, one of the senior most disciples of Pandit Nikhil Banerjee, and a senior and distinguished... and a very senior and distinguished sitarist of the Senia Maihar Gharana. After learning initially from his brothers, Pandit Biswanath and Pandit Aparesh Chatterjee, Pandit Devi Prasad was blessed enough to be trained by the great maestro himself. He received intensive training from Pandit Nikhil ji from 1965 to 1986, at his untimely demise, till his untimely demise. After this, he was blessed to receive training from Ma Annapurna Devi herself. Later, he became a Gandavan disciple of the great Ustad Ali Akbar Khan Sahib. Pandit Devi Prasad Ji has to his credit innumerable performances in India and abroad on AIR and Doordarshan. He has to his credit several CDs, background music, scores for films like Aradhna, Amar Prem, etc. And he has written a book on the sitar. He is a teacher, an outstanding teacher, and has won many awards, such as the President's Awards Award, Surmani, Sangeet Praveen, etc. Our next speaker is Pandit Parth Pratim Chatterjee, an esteemed and accomplished sitarist. He received initial training in vocals from his mother, Srimati Rama Chatterjee, and in sitar from a respected father, Sri Prabir Chatterjee. Later, he was privileged to receive training from Pandit Nikhilji himself for a very extended period of 12 years. After Nikhilji's untimely demise, he became a Gandavan Shagird of Ustad Ali Akbar Khan Sahib, who gave him the opportunity to teach in the United States Ali Akbar Khan College of Music every summer. Pandit Parthaji has performed and taught all over the world. He was invited by the ICCR to promote Indian classical music in Indonesia. He has been a teacher in the University of California, Berkeley, and Rabindra Bharati University. Since 2011, he has been a guru at the ITC Sangeet Research Academy. He is a recipient of the award, the Puttaraj Gavai Award in 2013. In 2008, Pandit Parthaji, along with his son, Sri Purbayan Ji, a very gifted sitar player himself, and the extremely talented great tabla artist, Pandit Anindo Chatterjee, toured the US, naming his concert tour Legacy and dedicating it to the memory of his guru, Pandit Nikhil Banerjee. Our next speaker is the brilliant tabla artist, Pandit Abhijit Banerjee, who started conducting music at a very early age. At the age of 4, he started learning tabla. At the very tender age of 4. And after that, he studied vocal music and learned the violin. He is one of the leading disciples of his guru, the legendary Pandit Gyan Prakash Ghosh Ji. He has accompanied almost all the stalwarts of Hindustani classical music at prestigious venues and festivals in India and abroad. He was blessed to accompany Pandit Nikhilji himself on his foreign tour when Pandit Abhijit Ji was only 20 years old. He is the founder of Dhwani Academy of Percussion in Los Angeles and Kolkata, and has trained and is training innumerable students through it. Our last speaker and also moderator is Sri Anindya Banerjee, a renowned sarod player, musicologist, writer, actor, and director. He started learning under Ustad Ali Akbar Khan Sahib himself. He has also trained under several maestros, namely Ustad Bahadur Khan Sahib, Ashish Khan Sahib, Dhyanesh Khan Sahib, and of course, Pandit Nikhilji himself. He is the sole performer on the rare instrument Sur Sringar. He is an advisor to universities like Rabindra Bharati and Vishwa Bharati. He regularly performs, teaches, and conducts lecture demonstrations all over the world. He has to his credit 5 acclaimed books and documentaries on music and musicians. He has won the Surmani title and senior fellowship from the government of India. He has also starred in 15 Bengali movies. And it is with great pleasure that I express my gratitude on behalf of this group for attending this function and making it a memorable one. And I hand over the proceedings to Shri Anindya Ji himself. Thank you.
Namaskar, Madhura Ji.
Namaskar.
Thank you for introducing us. But as I told you before, informally, that it sounds like the cooking recipes.
Yes.
Recipes are very nice to hear. You add this thing, you put that thing, you cut this vegetable and make something. But when you eat, you will find it's rubbish. I mean, so in my case, it's very applicable and appropriate. However, so before we start, we should pay our personal homage and respect to the great maestro Nikhil Bandyopadhyay, because we all were very much connected to him. If not musically, we are also connected to him, and still we are musically connected. So, as our according to our custom, we should start with our elder generation and with elderly person, with Devida. But before that, I will ask Abhijit, do you have still time to listen to Devida first, and then you can
of speak? Course. Because No. It's my pleasure. Devida is the senior most person, and yeah,
because
please,
you have
please
got
go
some,
ahead.
Some
yeah.
preoccupation, that's why I'm asking yeah. you. So, Devida, welcome yeah. and pranam to this yeah. This webinar, we can call because of the modern term webinar on Nikhil Banerjee, Pandit Nikhil Banerjee. The
yeah.
first thing I'll ask you, it will be a little personal, how you came to know him.
First, let me talk about Panditji, Pandit Nikhil Banerjee. So let me introduce, let me tell my gratitude. I am fortunate enough to pay my deep regards to Pandit Nikhil Banerjee on his 89th birth anniversary. And he was my idol, my pole star on my life. So, could you please put your question once again?
Well, how did you meet him? How did you go to him? How could you learn to him? Because
look,
you were learning from your uncles and Operesh Chatterjee at that time, one of the very
correct.
Famous. Yeah.
Correct.
Yes. So then suddenly, how could you want? Went to learn with Nikhil
Banerjee. Yeah. So when I was a boy of sixth grade, so I was listening all the time, as because I was not playing that time sitar, and my elder brother was playing, and there was a concluding program over radio, 10 to 11 p.m. Every month. I used to listen him. And from that time, that was on my mind, if I get the opportunity in the future, he will be my guru. I must go to him. You know, then my dream was with me. And in the year 1965, May, it was probably 25th of May, still I was under the guidance of Pandit Operesh Chatterjee, and I had to fill the form of Minister of Education, National Scholarship. I wanted to be a part of that. So I called Pandit Nikhil Banerjee over phone, and he agreed. And gave time next morning at 9 o'clock, and I was there, and I approached him that I want to be his disciple. he refused immediately. Immediately he refused, told me, no, I have no time. I am a concert player, so I am not thinking to teach now. Then there was I can say, tag of war between him and me. And after 2 hours, he agreed to give me, he gave me the consent letter. And subsequently, I got the National Scholarship under his guidance for 3 years. That was my entrance to him in 1965. Probably July, he called me to play before him.
Okay. So, in this context, I would like to refer that Nikhil Banerjee was one of the youngest sitar players who started playing in Calcutta Radio. It was John Gomez, student of Inayat Khan, who took him to radio station at the age of 7 and make him play for the radio. He was one, there is a section called Golpo Dadur Ashur.
Got it.
Okay, where he started playing. So this is one of the very rarest thing, and I mean, it's a very privileged thing at that time. Because at that time, to play in a radio considered to be a great achievement. And even he was a mere kid, it's not even a boy, he's a mere kid of 7 years old. Because in this context, I would like to refer that his sisters used to study with my mother in one of the schools in Calcutta. So in that context, my Nikhil Banerjee was my mother's friend too. So in our house, every month there were some musical soirees. So once at the age of 9, he and his brother played in our house, Rag Narayani of Kafi Tat. And the way his performance was so scintillating that the audience stood up on excitement that how could a boy of 9 years old could play such an can give such a recital. So
Correct. So
from that fire was from that time, I mean, onwards. Okay, fine. So I'll now request Parthoda how he got the chance to go to him and learn.
Well, my story is almost close to Devida's story. I was desperate to meet him and to study with him, and I directly went to his house one evening in Jodhpur Park, and he spoke to me and explained the same thing. He said, even, you know, in Calcutta, I am part of the Ali Akbar College of Music, but I don't get the chance to even sit and teach there. I've been touring around. So you have to learn all these things. So finally, I was then a student of, Calcutta University, studying MA in English Literature. So he asked me, what do you do besides playing sitar? So I told him he had some kind of, I would say, soft corner and a high degree of respect for anything which is good and great. So for studies, he just felt curious and he just asked me, so how can you manage to do both things? I said, I don't know about that at this stage, but I know that I love both of them. So that's how the first day finished. And then I used to try to fall to his feet in every concert that I went. And he would just give me a look of indifference and move away. So this way, 1 year passed away. Next year again, but I didn't give up. So I was all along trying to approach him that way. And then finally one day he told me, okay, what do you practice? Come within a week's time, like that, come with your sitar and play. So I went there, I played, I remember, for 5 minutes or 10 minutes, I don't know, but then trembling with fear and naturally without any clue, he heard me and he said, well, it looks like that your mind is going ahead of your hand, but you have to learn. You have to learn. This is classical music. You have to go through the process of training, this and that. And then the first day, out of nowhere, he just told me about Murchana and all these things. And then he said, no, go. So after 1 hour or so sitting there, I came back again. Then again, after 2-4 months, I practiced those things and then asked him, called him. The most honest thing about him, I must say, is that somehow he was not interested in going round and round. He would say straight away. When I said, I've been practicing the things that you told me to practice, then he said, oh, really? Okay. So call me next month. Then next month I went there. Again, the same thing happened. Same thing. No, no, you have to study. Then, but in the process, he told me one or two things more. So one or two years almost passed away this way. And then finally, some kind of a miracle, I got a chance to serve him, to give service to him in some way. So then he told me that, well, it seems you are not going to quit. So, and my father was also, important in that episode, helping him with things which were a little complicated, like tax and so on, this matter. So then there was some kind of a closeness of connection. And then after a few days, he told me to write his letters and if I could do that. And then I started going there more frequently. So finally, after 2.5 years or so, I settled down to learn a little bit, one or two lessons like that.
Thank you. Before I go to the next question, actually, I would like to read a few lines in Bengali. Actually, it's an article by then music critic and musicologist and music article writer, Sandhya Sen. She wrote an article taking an interview of Nikhil Banerjee in the year 1979, 5th February. It came out in Jugantar, one of the Bengali newspaper. So where Nikhil Kaka or Nikhil Banerjee has told that, Ami shekhai na keno, jar ichche amar kache kichu janat thakle jene jete pare. তবে গুরু হবার যোগ্যতা আমার নেই। আমি নিজে এখনো বোম্বে থেকে অন্নপূর্ণা দিদির কাছে বসে তালিম নি। বকুনি গালাগাল খাই আর ভাবি কত বড় সৌভাগ্য যে এখনো গুরু নির্দেশ পাচ্ছি। Well, if we say in English that he wanted to mean that he doesn't want to become a teacher because he's still learning. This interview came out in 1979 in one of the Bengali newspapers. And in that interview, he said that I don't want to teach because I am still learning and still learning with Ma Annapurna Devi. So I don't have that mind to teach, kind of something like that. So in this respect, I will ask again, Devi the first. So what do you think about this and how he taught at that time? What was his teaching procedure? Then I'll come to Parthada.
Thank you, Anindo, asking me. So one thing I like to say that when Madhura was speaking about me, she expressed that I learned under Pandit Nikhil Banerjee, then I went to Annapurnama. This is not true. So I was under the guidance of Nikhil Banerjee in 1965, and parallelly, 1968, I was under the guidance of Annapurna Ma when she was staying in Kolkata, and I was there and I asked the permission from him, and he gave the permission. So parallelly, I was learning from him when he was in Kolkata. I was there when Annapurna Ma was in Bombay. I was there. So parallelly, I learned from both of them.
Okay. And what about Parthoda?
You ask me about his method of training or what?
Training and how he was teaching at that time.
Well, it was not that you go there on a schedule of class like you do. I used to go there every Saturday, Sunday, like that, as much as I could. And then he told me that, you know, if I teach you this much, you have to do this much.
Yes.
Yeah. Teaching does not mean spoon feeding. Mm. So I used to go there. You can come, you are welcome. Come, watch me, my practice. And then, you know, because I could not ask him several things, I didn't know anything. I was less than the kindergarten level at that stage, you can say. But then I was completely overwhelmed when I went to him, and I used to listen to him. But in course of time, I realized that things got into the mind and they settled slowly, slowly. It is definitely, I would say, that my mother's training of vocal music helped me a lot.
Okay.
And then, sometimes he would teach one thing, a composition. When I look back, I can see that he taught so many old compositions of Maiyar that are very traditional compositions that we know, you all know about it. So he sometimes taught, and then again, maybe when he's on tour, he could not teach. Again, he would come back. It was not like a regular schedule like that. But I used to go there. I used to play theka. As you know, Pandit Arindo Chatterjee, Devida's nephew, he used to go there. That's how we became very good friends. And he saw me giving theka so many times, sitting there with him. So you learn to feel the lay, how to go. So all those things, naturally, it's a composite kind of a training. Then also sometimes he was just singing and I would have to be only singing, not by playing on the sitar. So mainly singing, difficult thing. And then there was no question of asking techniques, that how I pull, from which note I pull, or how I do. It's all your funeral. You find it out for yourself. So, you know, at this level, I felt overwhelmed, but with time, I felt that I had my feet strongly planted on earth. Slowly, slowly, I felt that. And he was so honest, because he said that I cannot sit here and go and open a class for anyone like that for a long time. So things went on this way, and 12 years is not just a very short span. So that's how I believe in Gurukul, education goes that way. So this is the story, I would say.
In this this respect, I will ask Abhijit, that did you ever see Nikhil Banerjee teaching, or you accompanied him while he was teaching or something like that? Can you recollect something?
Well, before going to that thing, I just wanted to tell you that, you know, my becoming acquainted with Nikhil Banerjee, Pandit Nikhil Banerjee, is something very unique. So I just wanted to share the story, just a little bit, that I was learning from Gyan Babu at that time, and there was one organization, I think you know Anindoda, it used to have a small house concert kind of thing in Jodhpur Park. The name was Suchandam.
Yes.
Yeah. So I used to go there and listen to many people. So actually, before that, I was a big fan of Nikhil Banerjee, and I used to go and roam around his house just to see, this is the house where this great guy lives, you know. So I used to go there and I used to stare at that house. That was my, you know, and me and my sister both, we were a big fan of him. So, and then what happened, you know, before that I had a chance to listen to him when I stood first in Tamsen, my music conference in the middle of the night, and also in Bongo Sanskrit Sammelan. So I was mesmerized, but I didn't understand anything. I was just, because I was too kid. So what happened is that I played a solo in that program where Buddha Kaka was there and Kumar Mukherjee was there. So all these people were there. Probably you were there. And also famous sitar maker Hiren Rai, his son Bachuda was also there, and I think you and Amlanda was also there. And what happened is that next day, I went to college. I was a student of Scottish Church College, class 11. So I came back, and my mother told me that Nikhil Banerjee called and wanted to talk to you. So he told, this is the number, you can call him. So I just didn't take it seriously. I thought that, you know, some Nikhil Banerjee has called something. So I said, yeah, I will call him. My mother said, I think this is the famous sitar player, Nikhil Banerjee. I said, I think you have gone off your head, because, you know, it's just not possible. But anyway, I will call him, whoever it is. So in the, I came and, you know, I was a college student, I mean, class 11 at that time. So I went to see my friends, blah, 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 and came back at 6:30 or 7 o'clock before I want to study. I just called him. And at that time, there are those black telephones, and somehow he picked up the phone. And then he said that, yes. And I never heard his voice, so I didn't know how it sounded. So he said that, well, I'm the Nikhil Banerjee, I play sitar. Then I just took it back that, you know, oh my God, I mean, now what to say? I mean, what shall I do with him? And then he said that, you know, you played very good. You are a student of Ganda. So somebody told me, so can you come one of these days? What are you doing? As Pathoda said, exactly. What are you doing? I said, I'm a student of, you know, at Scottish Church College in 11. Oh, in college, they are teaching 11, 12 years. Okay, good. So if you have time, if you can come, but don't bunk your class. I said that, no, I will come. No, don't bunk your class, but you have to come in the morning. I said, then I have to bunk your class, and I will come. So he said that, okay, so take permission from your teachers. I said, I will do that. So he said that, okay, so when can you come? I said, come. I can come tomorrow. Oh, then you are lying. You cannot take permission from your teachers. I said, then I was thinking that, you know, yes, I will take permission after later. So I just said that, you know, I will come. And he said that, okay, come at 9 o'clock and come straight. As you open the door, you will hear my sitar. So you come at second floor. That means Tintola. So I went there. And with my college bag and everything, and then I went. As soon as the door was open, I could hear that sound of the sitar, and really telling one another, it mesmerized me. It mesmerized me that, you know, I'm hearing something which I heard from, you know, from stage, you know, sitting behind or from the audience, and now it is just live. I can hear. So. जो बोलता है ना रोमटे खड़ा हो गया आई कैनॉट जस्ट गिव यू माय फीलिंग व्हाट आई फेल्ट एट दैट टाइम एंड देन आई वेंट अपस्टेयर्स एंड यू नो दैट यू नो समबडी ओपन द डोर एंड आई वेंट इनसाइड एंड देन ही वाज प्रैक्टिसिंग यू नो सो ही सेड दैट टेक द तबला एंड ही प्लेड थ्री तालास सो फर्स्ट वन वाज तीन ताल then rupak then jhaptal about half an hour so डेढ़ घंटा हम लोगों ने बजाया and then after that he said that okay so if you have time please do come whenever you have time so but before that when I started playing I just thought that oh my god you know please bless me that this should not be the last chance in my life to see him live like this And so God listened to me and he said that, you know, please come whenever you get time. But don't neglect your studies, huh? Okay? I said, yes, I will do that. And then when I came out of his house, I was not walking on the street. My feet was maybe 100 feet above the street. So that was my, so I just wanted to repeat this or I just wanted to tell that, you know, I don't know in this generation or nowadays any artist who will call somebody whom he does not know, and an artist of that stature, that, you know, okay, if you have, if you play good, please come to my house. And I have not seen or I have not heard any stories like this. So I just wanted to tell you that what kind of person he was, that a child, I mean, or a bacha, because unke samne, who has nothing, no achievement, nothing. So he is calling him to his house to say that, you know, please come. So that is something which we don't get. It's not for me, but I'm talking about his attitude. It's not my achievement, but it is his attitude. I have never seen like this. Anyway, now I'm coming to your question. Yes, I have seen not very actively, but I have seen him when I was in Austria. I have seen him teaching our friend Daniel Bradley for many days. And then I have seen also he used to teach in London, you know, Ratan Mukherjee, his daughter Seema. So Seema used to practice, and there were two ways. One or two days he used to be in the next room sleeping or something, and then he used to sometimes shout, "Oh, Seema, don't do this, please practice this." And then she used to practice. This I heard. And and sometimes she used to sit with Sita, and Seema used to sit with Sita, and I used to play the tabla, and he used to teach Seema some composition or something like that. But in a whole month of, you know, I was there with him for almost 3 months, and maybe 2 or 3 days I saw him teaching. But I saw Daniel more often because he was touring with Daniel. Daniel was driving with Nikhil Kaka. And so sometimes Daniel used to come, "Do you have time little to teach me?" So sometimes he used to say, "Daniel, maybe later." And sometimes one or two times he used to say, "Okay, Daniel, sit, what you are practicing, let me see." And maybe maximum 10 minutes I have seen to spend time like that, very short and very crispy, 2-3 things, and then it's done. So, but I have never seen him sitting with Sita, with Daniel, but, you know, telling him all these things. So these are the two experiences I had. But I have seen Parthoda many times coming to his house, and I could understand that, you know, he was practicing with me. After that, you know, he said, "Okay, now we have to go college." I said, "Yes, I have to go." So I used to go. Maybe he was sitting with Parthoda, but I have never seen him actually teaching Parthoda. Only once in the evening, once I went there because in Tahajibi, in Mausiki, Guruji told me that please bring a picture of Nikhil. So I went to his house in the evening and to take the picture from him and to give it to Guruji. So I went there and I saw that he was sitting with Sitar, and Bachuda was also sitting with Sitar. So the session was going on, but I could not stand that long, but it was a alap kind of thing. Not with tabla or something like that. I think he was teaching some rag, not any composition also, just teaching, but he was playing something and Bachuda was trying to imitate that. So this was my experience seeing him teaching.
Okay, thanks for that. Because in the music world, there is a notion that he was very reluctant to teach, or according to some critic, that he never taught anybody or something like that. But from you guys, we can understand that at least he could teach. I mean, he taught. I mean,
I just want to interrupt you. I was very later part of his life. I have not seen the part when he used to teach in Alibaba College. You have seen that and all these things. But he used to tell anybody and everybody that I don't teach. And I have seen many people coming to his house and say that, well, he used to send to Ajay Babu or somebody, But he used to say that, you know, that I have seen.
Maybe that is a later part of his life, but earlier he used to teach because he taught in our Aliyabha Khan's college, he taught. I mean, some Devida knows like Govinda Chandra Addi, Gopi Mohan Bose, Sunil Das, I mean, Kushal Das's uncle. They also all learned from Aliyabha College of Music with him. I also learned with him because he took 2 months in classes in our Aliyabha College of Music, and he taught Jaunpuri and Durga. And like repeating, taking Parthada's word, I was not in a position to learn from him in that standard. I mean, he taught Jaunpuri. I still remember the composition in Rupak Tal. And actually the Durga he taught because Bahadur Khan sir was teaching us Durga. So he asked which raga we are learning. So then we said Durga, so he taught Durga. Okay, fine, that is kind of, we are not take much more time in on this particular point. But taking Abhijit's point, that when he entered his house, he was mesmerized by his sound of sitar. Okay, so now I will ask Devida, can you throw some light on this? Because you are already learning from someone else and then you decided to go to Nikhil Banerjee. Why? Is this the mesmerizing sound you heard? Or what do you think? What you can
Thank you. I told you earlier that when I was a boy of sixth grade, my dream was from that time, I could be the student of him. And I started my career with my elder brother, and my first guru, then Pandita Prasadji. And during my training right over there, I was trying to catch him. I told you already. When he agreed, so I started going there every day. Do you know that? Every day, I used to listen to him every day, every morning. I was there, and other half, I was practicing after coming back home. So I listened a lot. And when he used to tell me, bring your sitar, so I was there, and he was sitting on a mora, you know, mora. I do not know what will be the English. Kind of,
yeah, cane stool.
Yeah. So cane stool. He was sitting over there as because he was singing. He was singing. I was trying to follow his singing, and sometimes most of the times I failed. Difficult mind work, difficult miserables work. I failed. Then he took my sitar and sold. Never he brought his sitar to me, you know. So I was habituated learning with his vocal music, and it was good with me when I went to Annapurnama. The same procedure she followed, and Baba also, Baba Ali Akbar Khan. I was very fortunate. 4-5 times I got Baba with his sarod.
Okay. Now I request Parthuda to throw some light on this point.
On which point?
The point, why did you go to Nikhil Banerjee? Why not to other, not to Ravi Shankarji, not to Vilayat Khan sir? They were already prevailing there. They were at the time greatest sitar players.
Well,
is it that mesmerizing sound which Abhijit said that, or something else?
No. I did not have that much of impression about the tonal quality, the brilliance, and of all those things. Okay. To be honest, I was very, very fond of Vilayat Khan's sound. And I liked his tans, his mithas, his sweetness, everything, until I heard him. Because, you know, my interest in music grew all around vocal music. So when I heard him, I could feel that it was not just sitar. It was the entire music itself brought life to me. It could not be better anywhere in terms of whether you think now of alap or even in composition or taan or anything, I felt completely carried away. I felt that this is what it should be musically. So much convincing, so natural, so great. And then later on, this question of tonal quality did strike me much later. Then I started to think, what is the reason this sitar sounds? Then I saw that it is not the sound of the sitar. It's the mind that you are hearing through the sitar.
Absolutely.
It's a soulful tone. It's the expression that comes. It's the novelty, the greatness, the uniqueness, all those things. You know, I cannot describe why particularly I was drawn.
Yeah, because actually, if we go back, we will find that Nikhil Banerjee's mostly training was with the instrumentalists. He learned with Dhruvatara Joshi, he learned with John Gomes, he learned with Radhikamohan Moitro, he learned with Mushtaq Ali Khan Saab, apart from his father. And then he learned with Annapurna Devi. Let me finish and then you, Devi. He learned with Virendra Kishore Rai Chaudhary, who was basically an instrumentalist, but he learned mostly Dhrupad and Dhrupad bandishes from him. Mm. Yeah, but I think it was Amir Khan who proved, influenced a lot, because Amir Khan used to say that meri awaaz hi meri gaayaki hai. That way, probably he wanted to bring a sound from which people can tell that this is Nikhil Banerjee. Same happens with Ravi Shankar Ji, Bilayat Khan Sahib, and Baba Ali Akbar Khan Sahib also. That the very first toka will give you the impression that this particular person is playing. So probably this is the point I wanted to raise, that this mesmerized all, everybody, you, not only you, everybody, those who are follower of Nikhil Banerjee, even not follower of Nikhil Banerjee, even the music connoisseur, they all like that sound, that music, that sound. So that I wanted to bring out from you. This is the point, main point. Now, before I go to Devida, because we are continuing, we don't have much time, you have to be also very brief. What do you think about his raga approach?
You ask me?
Yes, please.
Okay, raga approach means, in one word, I can say the presentation of his rag, if that's what you mean. It's
yes.
Nothing other than the format of his presentation.
No.
Then the structure or what?
No. What was his focus, approach to the raga? When he used to play, suppose he's playing Yaman. So what was his approach to the raga? Everybody has got some different approaches. No. How he starts, what he...
That's what I'm coming to. It's essentially a matter of structure. You are there on the stage. You are given an allotted a time for 45 minutes or 1 hour or more or less. And then you have to present that rag within that time. That is what it is at the end of the day. Right?
Yes. Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. So taking that into consideration, I'm trying to say only one word is compactness and totally devoid of any kind of digression here and there, very direct. And the rag comprehension was so good that within that 40 minutes, amra bangla jeta ke shusongbaddho kathara boli. Banglate, shusongbaddho. Very well knit, compact and well knit. There's nothing inessential, nothing which was just to show. Only those phrases would come which the rag demands at that point of time. So to make the best use of that, brevity, concentration, all these things are signs of great art. So that is a hallmark in one word.
Then
comes the question of degree or the detail that you can think of. But I don't think we have time for that. If you
And that is also very practical, unless and until you take sitar and demonstrate. And same question I would like to ask David also, if you can, in short.
Almost same with Partho. I do agree. But my approach is that, so his approach on to raga music Pandit Nikhil Banerjee, he must be considered for the completeness and the with emotion and depth. Three things I have marked, I have seen, I have learned. Moreover, with his melody, melodious tone, his development for establishing the rag was like this. He gradually used the respective notes of the raga and placed the notes perfectly along with the use of proper shrutis.
Okay. In this respect, I would like to quote late sitar player Subrat Rai Chaudhuri. He wrote a book called The Sound of Sitar. And in that book, in the page 96, he has mentioned that, I will read out, that he will always be remembered as the country's most technically complete sitar player and one who rarely failed in a concert. Nikhil Das' absorbing meditative music is missed more than anyone else's. I think you all agree with this one. I mean,
yes.
Yeah, Parthoda and Devita.
Yeah, I would.
Would you want to add something?
No, I just wanted to say that he had in him the best of all best musicians.
Yes.
What he got from his predecessors, like Khan Saab or Ravi Shankar Ji or Vilayat Khan Saab, all their good points, whatever was great about their playing, he had incorporated them into a unique whole. You know, it was one whole, and it never seemed that he was trying to copy this person, copy that person. No. It was so well assimilated by him that he expressed it with his own uniqueness. And the main thing that we really have to admit is that there was a virile imagination. If you don't have that kind of imagination, you cannot put it together so well. So naturally, it was the best of Khayal, best of Dhrupad, best of Tabla, everything is together.
Yes, because
and I need to quote a line of Pandit Kishan Maharaj Ji. I was in Varanasi for my performance and met him, and he told me a story. So when Pandit Ji passed away, so there was an obituary in the radio of Varanasi, and he was there. Pandit Kishan Maharaj Ji was invited to say something about Pandit Nikhil Banerjee and where he expressed his opinion. So Hindi mein ek sampurna sitar vadak ka dehant hua.
Yeah, right.
So well, actually, he told me that story.
Yeah, actually, when he started playing sitar, as we read, heard from gurus and others, his father used to take him. He was searching for a guru who will teach him properly, which was he was not fine getting. So his father used to take him all the great sitar players in Calcutta and to ask them to teach his son and so that he can learn something. But he was quite not satisfied. However, when he went to Alauddin Khan Saab at first didn't want to teach him, but later on when he agreed to teach him, he told him that I will teach you in the style of Qutubuddullah Khan. Qutubuddullah Bahadur. Actually, his name was Qutub Bakhsh. He was student of Umrao Khan from Tansen family. Umrao Khan was the inventor of Surbahar. So they used to play the Binka style with a very slow progression. That's why Alauddin Khan Saheb took him and to Yusuf Ali Khan in Lucknow, who is a very good sitar player and at the same time sitar maker, and make a sitar of Kachua Lao, means the flattened god sitar, which I've seen also. In the beginning, he used to play in that flattened sitar so that he could bring out that Surbahar element on his sitar with his depth, with the slow progression of notes, with 5-7 notes, a mid and all these things.
Correct.
But he heard so many people and he had the habit of hearing radio, because I used to visit him in the morning after my college. One day he asked me, did you hear today Bibhuti Bhushan Chatterjee on radio? I said, no, Kakua, because I was in class. He said, I said, what happened? He said, well, no, he played well, fine. I don't want to discuss about his playing, but he should have tuned his sitar properly. At least he's presenting in radio. So he was very minutely, he used to listen the 8:30 to 9 a.m. slot every day, whatever it's farod, sitar, vocal, whatever we used to. Because he had inside that thirst for learning. So as he learned from the other, what Pastor said, the predecessors, all the great sitar players, I mean, he had. So he incorporated all their good things into his sitar and he made a new style, which is a high seriousness. According to English literature critics, it's called high seriousness, which also came from both Aliyev Khan Saab, Annapurna Devin, and at the same time, Amir Khan Saab. So that's why he later part, he changed also his style of playing, which we'll discuss probably later. But now I will, because Devidas took the name of Pandit Kishan Maharaji, so tabla comes here. So being a tabla player, can you throw some light on his playing with tabla? I mean, the way he, how he used to play with tabla, how he used to analyze and the playing tabla, I mean, can you explain that? I mean, he's like his laikari or whatever, what he thought about laikari. As you played with him,
you're asking me, Aniruddha?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yes.
His approach to
Yes. Let me tell you. I joined him at the very end of his life. Rather, I would say that when he was a complete sitar player. So, and I was too little, really, to be able to, you know, it was, I was always mesmerized by his sound. So I was not in a position to really look at it in that aspect as all these big tabla players used to look at him. But I just wanted to tell you one or two things, like when Kishan Maharaj's word came, he also mentioned many times about Nikhil Kaka in front of me, and when he came to know that I used to play with him, he just told me that, you know, you had a fortune to be with somebody, a complete musician. That he told me, so I will never forget that. Now about the tabla play, about a tabla, from the tabla player's point of view, I would tell you a story. That, you know, in Stuttgart, I was playing with him and he said that, let's play dhamar. So I said that, yes, okay, fine. And he started dhamar. And I started playing. So after 15, 20 minutes maximum, he changed the raga and I could feel on stage that he was not at all happy. Rather, he was angry on me. So... And then he came out after the, and then he played a long Tintal Drut and, you know, played just like that. And then I came out and I didn't say anything. I could feel that. And he said that, you know, didn't Gandhar teach you how to play dhamar, how to teach dhamar? You were playing Rupak in dhamar. You were playing Arasutal in dhamar. Do you know how to play dhamar? I said that, yes, you know, 7 beats. With 7 beats, there are so many thals. Then why it is different from other thals? Dhamar, you should know, you know. And then he, at that time, then he, in the night, we came to the hotel and he again opened the sitar, which is something for me. And he started playing dhamar with his bolbanis, you know, all this. Then he explained that these are the sitar bowls or sarod bowls I play here, and you have to play like that. So, and dhatate dhakate, and you know that he learned also tabla from Gan Babu. So he used to know tabla. So he just showed me that, you know, this is the thing you have to play, and go back and ask Gandhar to teach you dhamar properly. So this is one thing I have learned from him. So he was very serious, not only about the ragas, but about the dealing about the talas, talas personality, taal, how you deal the taal, except all these, you know, tihais and all this kind of, which is nowadays, you know, coming too much. But I think he used to look at the tala with its, you know, and try to deal the tal with its, to explore its personality. Tal also has its personality, so he never used to exploit that, and he used to, you know, he never used to take it for granted, and he used to approach like that. Another thing is that you could see maybe he used to love me or something like that, and I was, you know, very young boy in front of him. He used to give me ample chances to play whenever I wanted to play. Sometimes I wanted to play and he just looked at me and laughed, and he just kept a gut, and I played, and maybe I have overplayed sometimes, which I feel nowadays, looking at the recordings, old recordings, but he never told me anything. And he said that, okay, so when, you know, very silently he used to tell me that, you know, you have to think about the measurement, okay? So if I play like this, you have to play little bit less than that. Try to think about, try to listen to me, what I have played, and then you try to do something along that line, not go with whatever you learned. And then also he taught me some of the bowls of what he learned from Guruji, which I also knew. And he was asking me that, do you know this composition of Gyanda? Do you know this composition of Gyanda? So as a tabla player, whatever I have seen Anindora, that he was very serious about treating a tal in its proper way.
Okay, thank you. Can you, Devida, say a few words? Very brief, because we don't have much time. We have to discuss certain other things.
So, I have seen he was playing etan, and he described the tabla bowls later. So, the tabla bowls, and he imitated the same and reflected on his tan. That I have heard many times.
Okay, Arthoda.
Yeah.
About, I want to, can you say something about his loikari?
Well, personally, what I am saying is my own opinion. It may not be the same with others, but I feel that he was always trying to give the best in the performance, in whichever way it could make the rag express itself. So when he did laikari, it did not mean that he would have to always go for laikari. But when he did it with very much, strong common sense and with 100% sureness, keeping all the beauty and then again getting back to the sur. Means the sur would never be disrupted because of laikari. That was his complete, total awareness every time. So
that
he
means used, absolutely marvelous balance of rhythm and
exactly.
melody.
Yeah, exactly.
Rhythm and melody. Yeah.
Because he felt that rag is the most primary thing, most important thing, which overrides all other things.
Yes.
So laikari comes, or even, but the lai is very important. It's not important always to do laikari, to deal with the lai, but lai, because
in rhythm,
here is one thing that I must mention, that towards the end, he told me once that you guys always play vilambit gat starting from 12 and goes onto the som, and you go to maintain that structure. Why don't you think, at that time he was under the overpowering influence of Amir Khan Saab, as you said.
Yes.
So, have you ever heard the Vilambit songs that he used to sing? So, convert them to Tintal and then make your Mughra shorter than the 5 beats. So, all these thoughts, which later on triggered into my mind, and I tried to play at that moment, I didn't realize. But you know that a mukhra coming from the 15th beat. in Kedar. You know, one or two things, just one or two, not many. But that opened my eyes, and that required tremendous amount of control of life. Like totally like the singer. So very subtle use of lay, that was always there, but not a big, you know, laykari. We are doing laykari now. It goes into 3 and 5 and 7. No, nothing like that. Mechanical, nothing. Ravi probably also, will agree with this.
Yeah.
This and also, yes. I mean, I sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to say that once I played in London, he was practicing some. So he Vilambit Tindal, and he started the Gath from 14th. And I was, you know, I was very young, but I used to ask many funny questions. I said that this is Amir Khan Saab's this thing. This is Amir Khan Saab's thing. So he said that, so if I play, do you have any problem? I said, no, I don't have any problem. Then just play. Let me try this. I said, yeah, but you know, this is something. Is it sounding weird? I said, yeah, we have never heard it. So hear it now. And then I said, okay, fine. So actually, this happened. And another, Kishan Maharaj used to say that, you know, making tans and tihais and all this kind of thing does not make you a laykar or laydar. So there is one laykar who composes according to, who pre-composes, and there is laydar who sees the lay. And Nikhil Banerjee was one of those people who sees the who knows the exact point.
Yeah.
So that is where, that is the thing. He used to tell me. And I also felt that.
Actually, the old thought of playing was with tabla or pakwaj, whatever maybe, was to analyze the taal. You analyze the taal and you play. Eh? You don't have to make tihais. Tihais came much later on. It was to play different types of tans, break the rhythm, break the tans and make it it's very difficult unless and until you play, but it's you have to analyze the taal and you have to play according to, because you cannot play tans of teen taal into jhap taal, because you have to go according to the jhap taal way or teen taal way or dhamar way, whatever maybe. So he did that way. And that particularly, he also did little bit of laykari, which sounds nice and which goes with the taal. It's not that in teen taal you should play 7 beats or in 7 beats you will play 5 beats, something not like. If it goes, if your mind goes with that, with the raga, like in Darbari Kanda, you cannot make too much laykari or something like, because that approach of the raga or nature of the raga is different, which he maintained. I believe, and everybody knows that. And so, Pastor, please.
One line. He, when there was a question about, I was asking him about this tihai business.
Yeah.
He said that more important is the amat, not the tihai.
Yeah.
How beautifully you can arrive at the mugra. How much aesthetically, instead of making, you know, just the tihais you can prepare at home. 100 tihais, you might not be able to play even 5 correctly on the stage when you are going to play. So that was his philosophy. Very, very essential.
Yes. And he was so strong in taal because he learned tabla also with Gyan Babu.
Yeah.
Because I remember one day, one morning, when Adil Kaka was practicing, Vilaskani, Tony Rupak, Obhijit was playing tabla, but that tabla was broken. So Obhijit told him, how could I play on that tabla? He said, no, just make some sound. Just give the teka, make some sound. So he was so much involved with the tabla. And one time I also still remember he showed you some tukra or gotha or something. And then Obhijit asked, it was something different. He asked, where from did you get? He said, I learned it from Amir Khan Saab. Because Amir Khan Saab also used to play tabla before he started singing. So he remembered all these things. He had a brilliant memory also.
Used to remember Gyan Babu's composition. He told
me. Of course.
Yes, very much.
Actually, now I would come to about his tans. Devida, can you explain the type of tans he used to play and how it differed from the others? Other sitar players.
Unparalleled. He was unparalleled making tans. Is really very, very difficult.
No, I know it's difficult to, without sitar is difficult, but can you still, because lots of students and musicians are hearing our program, so they can at least learn or know something, the types of band used to play.
My opinion is that when he plays a taan, that can be simple way. The next taan should not be equally placed, you know, and the area, choosing area means mandra madhya taar, always he was not using. Finally, he was using all three octaves. So, and with different rhythmic patterns.
Okay. Parthoda?
Fundamentally, he emphasized always going for the taans which will be appropriate for the chalan of the rag, which will be in keeping with the chalan of the rag. Number one, the first principle of his philosophy on taan was you must know the chalan properly, then only you can compose your taans. Then, other emphasis was that sapat taan he very much liked. So, a lot of riyaz of sapat taan. Some paltas, he was not really a big palta man, you know, not playing 100 paltas and then, but because at the later stage when he was following Khan Saab, he followed also Ghulam Ali Khan Saab singing and D.V. Paluskar singing. Mm-hmm. So for him, the taan pattern was Vilayat Khan on one side very strongly. So, but then he never cared for anything stylized. Nothing that his style. No. But what the rag demands, how I would sing the rag when I'm singing. Therefore, he went for all those vocal patterns. So he played the chhoot taan. He played the pech, bal pech, all taan circular, which all vocalists do. And then a lot of gamak taan. Yeah. Fantastic gamak he played.
Yes.
And you know, chhoot taan was very important for him because he used to play like the taans that Amir Khan Saab sang. Incredible taans. Anindo knows he even played some recordings in that.
Yes.
Yeah. So incredible. I mean, in that Hangshodhwani composition, yeah. You remember that.
Yeah.
So those taans he used to glue. And then after the whole thing in the Khayal style, the taan is done, then he would go to the instrumentalist division, you know, that arena where you take ladi, you play incredible bol taans.
Yes.
And very, yes, very coot bol taan, like, you know, lad guthao kind of thing. Yes. Complete.
He used to play the sarod bols.
Sarod bols, dra and drada, like that. All these things. But those are all taans.
Yes.
See, he played those taans. So, you know, basically it was a mixture of all different varieties. That's yes. My feeling.
Because I remember he used to practice the first 1 hour or maybe 45 minutes, the murchana from lower octave to upper.
Yeah. Perfect.
100 times looking 100. At our with his big eyes from the high powered glasses. First, he used to play the just plain dance, then he used to play with gamak. Same thing with gamaks. And then he used to take a jod of kind of whatever rag he used to take, and he used to practice like that. Then if someone tabla players come, then he used to join with Gath and all.
Yes, exactly. So exactly.
Actually, we also when learned, we was told that Guru Mantra is Murchana.
Murchana.
You have to practice every day, which he followed. Which he followed, I mean, till his death, I mean.
Yeah.
So that is a very important thing. So the students who are hearing our conversation should give proper focus on playing murchanas. I mean, paltas are okay, but murchana is a very important thing.
Absolutely. Lots
of ragas are also come out with murchanas, and you find lots of ideas of taan. So in this respect, now Parthoda, can you throw some light on the tone, on the jowari of his sitar? Is that helped a lot in playing those taans and all these things?
Well, Patra, before you go, I just wanted to ask you also one question. Is that along with Anandita, can you throw some light on the weight of his stroke,
which I found.
I mean,
okay. I try to tell you whatever I felt. Maybe they are correct, they are not correct, but I'm just trying to share my experience. So, first of all, the question is what Anindo was asking. What was the question? Repeat.
I mean, his tone of the sitar,
Jowari
and all these things.
Yeah.
It's all together, I mean.
Yeah. I the Jowari of the sitar, I don't know, Devida would be able to also throw light on that. He never really liked a very close Jowari. Never. Because I kept my Jowaris sometimes too close and he said, oh, it is horrible. You cannot listen to it. That's why he was not, there was a common concept among people, even nowadays it prevails, that Nikhil Banerjee's sitar always has a very bund Jowari, as if, you know, it's choked throat Jowari. But none of the great sitar players ever like to have a Jowari which has no color, which has no brilliance. So his Jowari was not closed that way. But there was a secret, there was something more to it, which is he used a little thicker strings. I don't know, I cannot say 100% conclusively because I never had the guts to ask him these things at that time. But probably when he was playing duets with Khan Saab, he had to have a different concept of the sound fitting with the sarod and with the long sitar neck like that. You have seen that. So he wanted to make the sitar sound like more or less more strong and sustaining like that. But his sitar, his sound, the Jowari of the sound, Pachu would also be able to throw more light on it. It was not all closed. It was just somewhere in between. But then after playing it for 1 or 2 days, it would give the best. In the beginning, it will never sound great. It will always sound like choked throat. After a few days, 2-3 days, if you really pull a lot. Devida, am I right?
Correct. After 3-4 days. After 3-4 days.
After 3-4 days, it will, it's like a new shoes. When you put it on, it hurts
so
your
it
leg.
It will smooth the main string.
Right.
The main area. Yeah,
exactly. But Abhijit's point is also very important here because he had so much control over the right-hand bowl. Dara dara and dara da dara da dara, along with all jukta bowls like dridar dara da dara da dridara, etc., etc. But so much control with this thing, he had very small palm, if you have seen that. Not a big, huge palm. But he could, that gave him the opportunity to jump also. His fingering, you know, if you try to adjust like him, you will fall apart. So he could reach those things from a tender age so accurately and so correctly that he used to get that sound. The ozan that we call it. Like, you know, tabla players, you also have, everybody has a distinct sound when it falls on skur or kinar, a distinct sound. You can figure out whether it is the sound of Keramat Khan Sahab or it is Zakir Bhai or anybody, you know, after 1 minute or so, you can understand. Here also, it's the same thing for him. When he used to play his instrument, he had a very, very impeccable taste about the sound. And he used to make it like that.
Not only that, Drida, number of times, repeatedly.
Yeah.
And with much weight.
Yeah. And it's very difficult to play on sitar. That kind of board.
Yeah.
Because we don't have much time, only 5 minutes left. So I would request in brief, maybe within a minute, if you can say, Devida, a memorable moment with him or a memorable concert of him, something like that.
I have memorable concert many.
Just one in 1 minute, so, something like that.
One or two, just I will quote here. So, It was for 1975, and I am quoting two occasions. 75 in a whole night music conference held at Kanchirapara near Kolkata in West Bengal. Pandit Nikhil Banerjee was the concluding artist over there. The organizer arranged Panditji staying in a private house at Kanchirapara. I was staying with him. And around 2 in the morning, he ordered me to bring his sitar. And we were under the mosquito net, as because too many mosquitoes were there. So I carried out his order immediately, and mosquito was short height mosquito, and he managed his sitar over there and played for 30 seconds with a tremendous speed. I never heard from him before. So he continued almost 30 seconds and gave me back his sitar Ragdev. Then I was astonished, and I was thinking that could possible by him. And that in the morning, 4 o'clock, he started his performance with Rag Jogia Kalengra, accompanied by Ustad Keramatullah Khan Sahib, and Tanpura accompanied by me. And other, which is, you will love it, on 22nd January 1977, Pandit Nikhil Banerjee performance at Bongo Sanskriti Sammelan at Brigade Prayer Ground, you know on Indu. Partho, you all know, Abhijit, you know, where I was fortunate enough to perform on the same stage. And Pandit Banerjee arrived around 3 a.m. His performance had to start at 4 a.m. And he started on time, Rag Ahiri. And after his performance, almost 2 hours, Pandit Shankar Ghosh accompanied him. Almost 2 hours he performed over there. And as soon as he stopped his performance, ended his performance, some gentleman jumped on the stage suddenly. The stage was too high. I don't know how he could do that. Jumped on the stage and put his head on his feet and was crying loudly. And he was assuring, Panditji was assuring him, "Don't cry, don't cry. What are you doing? What are you doing?" He was crying. So he was telling, I need to die right on your lap, right on your lap." And he was crying.
Devika, we don't have much time, so thank you for that. Parthoda, can you very brief?
I cannot think of any particular concert. I have
virtual not only concert, any memorable thing. I mean, even in something he has told you, or a joke, or whatever it may be. I mean,
yeah, the memorable thing I can say. One day he wanted me to play. Just take that sitar. There was a sitar which was full of dust in his room. I went there after 1 month or so. Take the sitar, play Sindhu Bhairavi for 5 minutes or 10 minutes, make like a EP recording. Can you do? Buddha was sitting there also. So can you show me? And then I played. It was so miserable. Then he said, "If I would play this, will you buy a ticket for 2 rupees and come to listen to me?"
Oh, great.
That was the end of it.
Abhijit, could you say something very short?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm telling you that, you know, I heard him singing Rabindra Sangeet once in Vancouver. "Hat diye dar khulbo na go, gaan diye dar khulabo." So he was singing that. So I said that, "Kaku, I mean, how, just one day, there is another incident that, and I just said, "Kaku, how can you say good?" He said that, you know, just surrender to God, it will come to you. Otherwise, you know, practice all these things does not make you in that level. Just surrender to God and then He will help you. So these are 2-3 things I just remember from, there are so many stories, but you know.
That's of course.
Yeah.
He was a very simple type of man, because I remember he was going to play a concert at Tala, and he was wearing a kurta, Punjabi, with the back portion was torn. So I couldn't resist myself and I told that Kaku, and this Punjabi's kurta is torn, how could you wear this and play? He said, well, people will come to hear my music, not to see my Punjabi or kurta, something like that. Even my Guruji Ali Bakhansa was like that. He used to a very ordinary kind of dress and all this. He was not very concerned about all these things. And another thing in the green room, when the organizer used to come and said, okay, Nikhilda, let's go to stage, start, we have to start your concert. So he used to say, follow Jaige to Kai Nana Koreasi. Kai Nana in Bengali means playing a kind of metal bass thing with a stick during the puja arti and the procession also. So he was quite humorous. There are lots of stories. We don't have that much time. I thank the host, Madhura Patwardhanjin and Nikhil, Nick, and Anushtubh. Anushtubh has taken lots of initiative for organizing this thing. And I thank my pranam to Devida and also to Parthoda and also to Abhijit giving us out their very valuable time. And we are all happy that they could join with us. And we hope we'll do it again, because to analyze a person and his ties, music, life, whatever, it's not a mere of joke. It's not possible for anybody to, do it in a time, particular time slot. It will take days after days,
Very true. Okay.
Maybe next time we'll have Devida or Parthoda and Abhijit all with their instruments so that they can play and explain all what we have discussed today. So before we conclude, once again we pay our personal homage, pranam, to the late maestro Pandit
Nikhil
Bandyopadhyay on his birthday.
Regard to you all,
and my hearty regard to him on this day, birthday, and all my viewers. And my best wishes to Anindo, Partho, Abhijit, and Anushtubh especially. He is very energetic and he is doing, he has done his best. And I also thank Madhuraji and her son, Nikhilji, and I wish my best. So I will listen one day. I have not listened to him yet.
Okay, thank you everybody.
Okay,
good night.
Thank you.
Stay well and stay safe. Yeah. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Anindo. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Some photos from his life, some photos with the speakers as well. Can we do it?
ঠিক আছে এটা কেটে দিই।